BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation.
New Arts Alive features the guest artists who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive. And with me as my guest for the evening is Micheal Winkler. And this is not the first time that I've met Micheal. He reminded me we had an exhibition of Micheal's work back in 2000, almost between the 20th and the 21st century. I mean, it seems so long ago. I'm having Micheal because of the transition that he has gone through, and the changes and the excitement with the same kind of information that he's putting. But he's getting something out of that. Once he puts it into that tube, it's coming out a little different. And that's what we're going to find out about tonight. And what I would like to do is have Micheal give us a little synopsis of what we're going to be doing and seeing his work, talking about his work, and sharing. So, Micheal, if you would.
Sure, James. For the last 35 years, I've been working with the same process. And the process is rigorous, it's structured, and it allows me to convert the code of language to an image. Connect the dots according to the spelling of words. It uses a matrix, which we'll talk about, to basically just create a geometric form from any word that can be written in using the Roman alphabet. So the medium that I work in is not the thing. It changes over time. I've worked with drawings, paintings, installations, but actually more painting lately, so we'll sort of head to that direction and talk about the paintings. But in the beginning, I'd like to talk about the process a little bit so that people understand where the forms come from and where the ideas have emerged. And the process was discovered by accident, so we could start there.
Okay, then would you like to have the image?
Yeah, let's take a
pull
look
up
at
the image that's on the. There it is.
The circle is just the 26 letters of the alphabet placed in a circle. You notice that the pentagon is on the five vowels, and you can see that the vowels are equally spaced because of the pentagon, but the consonants are not spaced equally between them. Initially, what I was trying to do was develop some. When I first discovered this by accident, I was trying to make nonsense words for a text sound composition so that I could use speech sounds without any connections to language, just the sound of language. And I was having trouble, so I decided I would put the letters of the alphabet in a circle and draw geometric forms to create nonsense words. And when I went to put the 26 letters in a circle spaced equally, it didn't work very well because 360 degree circle doesn't divide equally by 26. So as I was looking, trying to decide what to do, something came to mind, something I'd heard or read, that the vowels are the soul of the words and the consonants are the body. So I decided to see what would happen if I spaced the vowels equally and then spaced the consonants equally between them on the circle. And I ended up with getting this form. So then I started drawing geometric figures and ended up having some surprises as a result. And that basically changed me from, over time, from being a experimental music composer to a visual artist, a visual conceptual artist, which is what I am now.
But I think that that one thing, being that you started out as in the music industry, music field, and so making the words was more in the music sense. Not that it was, but you haven't changed. The medium has changed.
Right, the medium keeps changing.
Because I remember in 2000, you had a lot of works on stone. Mm-hmm. And besides graphic forms on flat surfaces.
Yes, yes.
Also, the way in which the spacing becomes very important as far as the letters, the top of the circle, as we see it, the spacing is wider.
Right, right.
And then as it goes around to the bottom, it's getting tighter.
Because there are more consonants between the vowels. And that's actually what creates the magic,
That's the whole crutch of the matter, right?
Right. It wouldn't work. Discovering this by accident made the rest of this whole process happen, which you'll see as we go through. Actually, we could look at the next image, which will show, actually shows the... what this if you connect all the letters with 325 lines, this is what you get. You actually get these circles and things happening. Those are all straight lines within the image.
Those are moiré pattern.
Mm-hmm. And so you can see how the spacing changes the symmetry of the whole system. I call this is actually a print that I did called All Words, because it's basically mapping the spelling of every word that you could possibly produce using the Roman alphabet. All words and non-words, I think, is actually what it says. And then if we can, actually, we could go to the next next image and see some actual forms that are created from it. So what happens is I basically, in this process, I just draw lines connecting the letters to spell out words.
Okay, first you select a word.
Right.
And then you start finding that word or that letter, not the word, the letter, each one separately, but you connect them.
Right.
By a line.
Right.
And then it's a configuration that word makes. And
all by itself. The word is drawn.
Yes.
The word
you
is
don't control
the
that.
No, I'm connecting the dots. All I do is take a ruler and a pencil and connect the dots. And the surprising thing is that you get the first word is enigmatic, the next word is structures, the next word is invent, and then there's chaotic and shapes. And the fact that the word structures looks like two structures and the word shapes looks like a star, and the form that you get from chaotic and the strange irregular form you get from enigmatic is all happening because it's already in language. I have no control over that because the circle of letter points is fixed. It's constant. It's the same in every one of those images. So when you see regular, which is the fourth one over in the second row, actually coming out in a symmetrical pattern or correspondences next to it, as compared to some of the other words such as mysterious. I think it's lines. I think that's
mysterious.
Yeah, I think I can't quite see the
mysterious.
Mystifyingly. Excuse me, mystifyingly. So mystifyingly is kind of irregular. You couldn't change those around and use a different form and get the result, yet it's all happening from language. And this is what hooked me on this. I found that these words look like they're concepts, like they're meaning, and there's no explanation for it, because language didn't evolve according to any, spelling didn't evolve according to any kind of a plan. So basically choices made by people that died long, long ago, many people over centuries that resulted in these spellings ended up making sense visually in a some strange way. And really there is no explanation for it at this point, but obviously when you see a word like axial in the bottom, the third row, the second word in, it defines an axial.
Look at the one even, which is right next to it to the left.
Defines even. So that's just EVEN making that triangle.
No base on the triangle, just the two.
And if I were to make that uneven, there would be a U going over to the N, UNE, and that would be an uneven line along the bottom of it. And that actually leads to the next slide here. The other thing that defies, this is a print, and here you can see axial at the top, then the word abaxial, which means away from the axis, and coaxial adds another axial to it. And of course, language is doing all this. I have no control. The word shapes is unshaped and misshapen are in the next line. All of that thematic change is happening because it's in the language, same as the word regular and irregular. And along the bottom there, you can see how effect fits inside the word cause. So this is just a mystery, how this could possibly happen, that these choices that people made.
We're going 30,000 years back, B.C.
In this print, the image on the side is one of the oldest, is a very old, I think it's 120,000-year-old piece of abstract art, and of course you see the axials in it, so I do try to draw some connections to what deep down in our symbolic nature might be causing us to structure something innately or involuntarily or without any intention of doing it. So I've been working with these forms, making prints, drawing them on stone, making installations, printing them in books for years. More recently, I've gotten away from making things complex. My installations were getting very complex, and I was bringing a lot of language into it and bringing a lot of concepts and ideas that were associated. And I was getting to the point where I thought you had to spend an hour in an installation trying to decipher the whole thing, and it was not the kind of art that I really wanted to produce. I wanted to get down to the essence of the forms themselves, because that's what I find fascinating is the actual spelled forms. So I started painting.
What is this circular?
That is, I think that's DNA, actually, top of a double helix.
In the bottom left
bottom,
side.
Yeah, forming that X in there. I think that's basically sort of suggesting that these forms are coming from our DNA in a sense, that the symbolic mind, by its nature, we create patterns, meaningful patterns.
But there is no center. In other words, you're not working, nothing is controlled from the center. It's all the outer parameter, the dots, wherever the letters are.
Right. The only difference in the circle, the E is at the top to rotate. I rotated the circle so that E would be at the top because it balanced the symmetry. Otherwise, it would be uneven because the spaces, the letters that are farther apart would not be evenly placed at the top. They'd be hanging off to one side. So I just turned it up, but otherwise, it's always the same. It's the configuration.
For 30 years.
For over 30 years. Yeah. And so more recently, in the last, I guess, 5 years, I've really started focusing on painting the forms.
But then when you were in, painting was not something you even thought about in 2000 at all. I mean, it was almost like it's a no-no planned or something.
That's true.
You know, but it...
And I'm still trying to learn how to paint at this point, even after 5 years. But fortunately, all it requires is taping. It doesn't require... I have to learn to use the paint in terms of getting clean lines, but I don't have to have the ability that a figure painter or, you know, someone, a really good abstract painter has to have. So I really consider myself more of a visual conceptual artist than a painter, although I'm working more and more exclusively in painting.
As I called you back in 2000, I called you a word sculptor. I now would call you a word painter.
Yeah.
Because you're painting words.
I think that fits. I think that's
very appropriate.
It's about
as simple as you can get down to it, isn't it?
This painting is actually the word lines, and I did this. This is, I think, 2011, and usually I work in 44 by 44 inch canvas with 2-inch lines, and I place one line inside the other line so that you can see the overlay. That's one of the things that first attracted me to painting, was the fact that I could show the overlay of the lines. And I just arbitrarily picked the color for this, and I would always make monochromes, but I would just choose a color that I thought would work well for the word, but it was just an arbitrary choice.
Is that still how you do it?
I'm moving away from that, and when we'll get to I'll show you the change that I've actually letting language do that for me as well. This is another painting, and the interesting thing about this painting is there's a mistake in it. And I've always thought that somewhere along the way, I'm going to forget to put a line in, or I'm going to get the line going where it shouldn't. One line wouldn't be overlaying the other line as it should. So this is the word structures and the word link. The word structures has a little... the two dots on the bottom on the left-hand side, there should be a line connecting those because there's actually a space between those two letters. The T and the U aren't connected as they should be in the word structures. I left that out by mistake, and I was going to go back and fix it, and then I kind of like the idea. It's a small thing, but it actually isn't the word structures if you leave that out. So it's something that I knew was going to happen sooner or later. It did, so I kind of keep the piece around.
Would you go back to the previous one? Notice how the line that goes down in the center, it's a line the same width all the way. Now, on this next one, you have it cut off, so it's at a... So it's at a point. Now that I find kind of interesting. What it does is it gives it some depth.
Exactly.
And you do that on each one of these, which means that it's going back.
Right.
In a way.
It is.
I mean, I'm just pointing.
No, it's absolutely why I put the interior line so that you can see that the small line on the right is L, I, and then the next line is I, to N, then it goes up to E and down to S. So you're actually seeing it move over the top.
But you see them working because of that, because if the line came all the way up and hit it, it would be...
Flat.
It would be purely flat. Here you are dealing with that space.
Three-dimensional space. And that's the
optical part of it. Physically, it's not.
Right. But it could sculpturally be, because actually when you're spelling, the form is moving towards you in a certain sense, conceptually, I mean in conceptual space. And one of the reasons I first became attracted to painting was because I could show that in painting. It was difficult for me to show it in drawing because I tended to work smaller, but when I was working with a 44-inch canvas, it was very easy to show the overlay.
Oh, you just put a piece of tape there.
So, and then you can see the same thing in structures, how one line on the bottom there, one comes in front and one line lies behind that cross line across the bottom. So that's the word structures, and link is the word next to it. Let's go to the next canvas here. This, the top word, the first word, is invent. Then we have even, the word you pointed out before.
On the right corner,
on the right. Then down on the lower left is uneven, and then the word extent is next to it. So I'm using this to show a visual theme, a structural theme, geometric theme, but language is creating it. So the statement becomes this...
Well, the object that has been created by those letters of the words fit the word, so to speak.
Exactly. So I like to play off themes a lot because a lot of times people will say that these forms are a coincidence, but thematic coincidence doesn't do thematic. So there's something else going on. You wouldn't have themes where words like even are becoming uneven and actually visually changing if it was pure coincidence. Now, what's causing it, I don't know. Whether it has, whether this structure carries through and has some other deeper visual meaning, I don't know. It's a mystery, and part of, I think, what I like about art is mystery and ambiguity. So the fact that this is happening is really what excites me. This is 88 by 88 inches. So I created this by taking four 44-inch canvases and putting them together to make this larger.
So this is one canvas, not four.
It's four canvases. It's
four separate canvases.
Yes, four panels make up this piece.
Okay.
And I either will exhibit it this way in a square or along a wall if I have enough space.
I see the lines in here when I look closer. I can see that. So you've stayed with your 44 by 44.
Right, almost almost exclusively.
There's an exception.
There's at least one exception. And this is kind of a tongue-in-cheek kind of a game that, this is the word abstract. So I'm painting an abstract painting of that's actually painted by, drawn by the word abstract. So this spell form
you're being truthful.
And here again, I'm just picking the color, just choosing something. It's an arbitrary choice. It could be blue, it could be green.
Yeah, but how are you picking it in this case, the color? I mean, you say arbitrary, but what does that mean?
I simply look at the paints that are available, and that I don't have to do a lot of mixing. I do stick to one pigment or one paint and just mix white with it, or the complementary, so that I can lower the value. And that's what happens in the back, is the value is lower.
So for each painting, that's how you work it.
Okay. Right. So there's a little bit. The main color is in the wide part of the line. And then the background has the contrasting color added to reduce the value, or the ground. And then the center lines, the really bright lines, are actually, they're not as white as they look on the screen. They're actually also the same color as the lines. So a little bit of white is added to bring them out. And then the dots, the other interesting thing in these paintings is that I show all of the letters, even though I'm not using them. And so they're just a little bit of white or contrasting complementary color to change the value of the dot so that they'll be there, but they won't overtake the canvas. But that's a change. That's something I'm slowly moving away from, showing all the dots, the ones that I'm not using, because it does... it's a uniformity that doesn't allow you to really look at the word form or the spelled form as an abstract form.
Well, it's a form of control in a way, because that's how you came by it, so that you have the whole circle there to show how it's arrived at.
It,
And now you're moving away from that.
I'm moving away from absolutely revealing, feeling I must reveal the process in every piece. So I'm showing the form. All the forms are created the same way, but I'm not always showing the dots because I don't feel like I have to. I think in the next piece I am. I still am. This is a piece done last year, and it's the word remarkable. And so I wanted to make a remarkable painting.
Wow, how can you miss?
That's right. So it kind of looks like a spinning top. I'm not sure what the word remarkable, what visually that should look like. And I do like to pick words at times that you have no idea what could express that. But this is constructed the same way, except that I think I'm actually using something other than the complementary in the background here. But again, it's an arbitrary choice. It's not something that came up through a process.
Is the dots that the lines start from and go to, are those dots the same lightness as the other dots that are around?
No.
Okay, I just wanted to be sure if
What I do is I take the base color, the wide part of the line, and I add a little bit of white to that so that when the idea, what I'm after is for the dot to be there, but for it not to be so strong that you can't see the geometry of the form easily.
Okay.
I don't want the dots to be significant, but I wanted them to be there. So it's very important to me. I spend a lot of time getting them to just the right tonality so that you can look at it and see the form as a whole, but also see that what's happening at that corner, that there's an actual letter there where things are meeting. So conceptually, I want it to be pointed out. I want it to be emphasized, but not emphasized at the expense of breaking up the smoothness of the form, which can happen. You know, all of a sudden a triangle just becomes two lines pinned together instead of a triangle if you make the dots too strong.
Now, the line that's on the top, is that determined by the order that you make it?
That's the spelling creates that.
Okay.
So if I were to go through the word remarkable, the bottom most point and the topmost point would be the first line, because that's R-E.
So that's
the first two letters.
That becomes a recessive quality.
Right. So that's why the lines that were drawn first would be look like they're behind the other lines, and they work their way out.
So you're using a constant.
Absolutely.
That's up to this point. Now that tomorrow it could be something else, but
I always let the word draw it. The spelling sequence is always going to be drawing the form, and it's always going to determine.
It's been the same always?
Always. The only thing is, I think, if I recall the piece that I did on stone at the New Arts Program 13 years ago, I didn't have a center line. So you couldn't see what line. It was just a solid line. So you couldn't see what the overlay was. It was they were meant to look like petroglyphs. And so they were just carved directly into it. And that's one of the things that painting allows me to show, that depth, which I hadn't always done. As a matter of fact, that didn't become really important to me until, probably the last 7 or 8 years, when I began to see the forms as being more dimensional. I think probably had something to do with you saying word sculpture, and I started thinking about them in terms of sculpture instead of flat, two-dimensional geometrics.
We've got to break for a minute for what is traditionally called station identification, and we'll be right back with Micheal.
You're watching New Arts Alive on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and an arts calendar, go to www.bctv.org.
Arts programming on BCTV is supported by the Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts and the Wells Fargo Foundation.
Okay, welcome back. Micheal Winkler is with us, and we're talking about his word paintings. And okay, Let's go to the next one.
The next painting. This is clearly askew. So the word that generated the form on the left side is clearly, and askew is on the right. And this is...
Those are two separate... 44 by 44.
Actually, these are 46 by 46.
Oh, you and put it, in a little...
It was a mistake, actually. Oh. So I ended up making some stretchers myself that weren't quite the right size. And oh. So then I had forgotten I was going to cut them down, so I ended up making them a little larger.
But
so
we can't tell.
I could have said it was 44. So unintentional, some... the other thing about this is that you can't see it on the screen very well, but these are actually, the background is rubbed with, it's oil and acrylic, and it was an experiment to just try and show some texture. You can see a lot of different textures going on in the background there, and I was playing with the idea of texture being text and texture in painting and just playing a little...
That's sort of like Da Vinci. You know, he was playing with materials, and that's why his piece of the Last Supper was done in a space that was had moisture in it. Besides, he, you know, things you don't do.
Mm-hmm.
But he was always playing with and trying to find out with materials. Same as you're doing here.
And except the difference is, of course, Da Vinci was a master painter, and I'm trying to learn how to paint. That's why.
Well, you know,
I'm doing it. So I would say that's the first time
I've
ever worked.
Actually, they're very similar in a way.
Worked with this, so
we're all learning.
let's go back to that painting just for a second. One thing I want to point out is that there aren't any dots on the outside of the forms.
That's right.
On this
that's
one.
The first one. Happened when? In 2012 or
when? This was, I think, 2011 as well. And I just wanted to see what it would look like, what it would feel like to me without having them there. And if I would do a close up, you would see that they actually are there. In structure, they're in the texture, but they're painted over. So you would see circles embossed in there.
You originally had them there,
mm-hmm. and then I just painted them.
They're
over.
Very faint.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Very. You'd have to inspect the canvas up
it's
close.
It's like looking into the water and seeing some stones or something down below.
Exactly. They. You'd have to. You might not notice them. I think the uniformity would show up.
Well, the background quickly. Here or the ground, so to speak, is. Irregular, and that would be because of the way in which you applied the surface that
and
you
I
spoke of.
I tried to make it has acrylic underneath, and I tried to make the brush strokes very uneven, and then I rubbed oil stick over the top of it to pick up on that unevenness. So I was actually using things like a roller and trying to make a texture, and then rubbed over to see what would happen. And I felt good about it, but it wasn't something that I wanted to continue with. So I thought it was a nice little experiment, but not something I wanted to make a whole series from. Now we're coming to a different
milestone.
Milestone here, very very recent. It always bothered me that I'm a process artist and that I allow language to make the image itself, make the form, but I was choosing the color at random. And I searched for some way to allow language to make the color as well as the form. And for a long time I had difficulty because of paint. Because this circle with the color wheel overlaid on the letters, it was something I came up with a long time ago, and I could do it digitally. Because of course I can plot exactly where the point for E would fall on the color wheel in relation to all of the other letters. Just basically by using a large enough. I think I used a wheel originally with 60 colors, so I could overlay these on it and find out exactly what color that would be. But the problem is that when you mix paint, other things happen. There are different levels of value. There are different tinting strengths. So, for example, a yellow has a very low tinting strength. So if you mix the same equal amounts of yellow and say magenta in white, the magenta will have a very, the pigment often will have a very strong, so you'll have this very dark magenta, and you'll hardly notice the same amount of yellow in a white because the tinning strengths of the paint are so different. But what solved the problem for me was actually I found some information from Golden Acrylics on how to balance tinning strength on some of their colors. And so what I did is took the vowels again, and the magenta that you see at the A is a pigment, a very strong pigment, and then the I is a yellow. It's actually Hansa yellow medium, so that's the pigment on I. Then the O was, I think, a green, a phthalo green probably, and the U is a phthalo blue. And then I found a way through their information to make all of those colors have the same tinning strength. And so then what I could do is mix, if I want, for example, the color of the C or the D or the B, I can mix A and I pigments together in that exact proportion that you see around there. So I actually get all of the other colors from those five basic pigments, and then I can get all of the other range of greens and everything. So I'm mixing them, and I mix them in that proportion, that same geometric proportion that you see there. So I'm getting this whole circle of colors from those five balanced pigments. Then when I draw the form, I'm actually getting a color mix of whatever colors. So if the word has five letters in it, I mix those five colors together. The only thing is, in order not to have the same word, some words have the same letters in a different order. So to solve that problem, the first letter, if it's five words, the first letter will have 100% of the pigment, the second letter will have 80%, then 60, 40, and 20% of strength. So I actually have five times
as
much.
Beforehand, in other words,
always the same way. If the word had 10 letters, then there would be a 10% difference in how much of each of those letters got added, with the first letter getting the most and the last letter getting only 10%, so 100% down to 10%. So basically, I'm allowing the word to totally control the color of the painting, and solving that problem has allowed me to take myself out further out of the painting, so that whoever those people were that made the choices in spelling are drawing this and painting this. They're choosing the colors, they're making the drawings from their choices of what letter, you know, what letter combination should make a particular word. And I have brought a painting with me that shows an example. This is the first one I've ever done, that I've ever shown, I should say, that's ever come out of my studio with this process. And if we could take a look at that.
Okay, right here. Now, the image that we see on the screen right now is dimensional. It has a dimensional quality to it, doesn't it? I mean, to me, the center is actually out.
That's actually not my doing. That was a color wheel that I found, yeah, and used from another source, from a general information source, basically.
Because the colors are stronger there. I mean, those are pure.
Right. Actually, the color wheel that I used to actually place the letters is, I don't think it's the same color wheel. I think I put that one in because I think it was so complex that for some reason I didn't have a proper image of it, or maybe it was didn't have a high enough resolution. But I ended up putting that color wheel in, which I think has only 20 different shades, may have more than that. I'm not sure how many, but to show where the, you know, basically to have a reference point for the color wheel. But to actually figure them out, I used a wheel with 60 colors broken into 60 possibilities. So if we could look at the painting that came from that process. Let's see. Maybe we could. That angle is getting a lot of glare on it there. That's a little bit better. Actually, the colors are not coming out. I think they might be too subtle for the imagery. It's got a golden color background and then an orange center line and then wide line. That's orange.
That's orange.
And then there's a light, very light orange in the center line there. So you can't
really...
The white,
what appears to be white. Right?
Yeah, yeah. You can't see
and
it
the background
well.
Is... Yeah, it's almost like a wood color.
Yeah,
then down here on the,
Yeah, yellow oxide, I think, is the.
Yeah.
And what happened is the orange. This is the word idea, and so the color actually came from the word itself. And the color that the word idea created is the widest, the color of the widest part of the line, that orange. Then I just add a little white to that color to get the center line. And then I added a little bit of black and yellow oxide to get the background, as to bring down the background. So I'm always adding the same color, the same black amount of black and yellow oxide to get the background in every painting. I want it to be a fixed process. The reason I add yellow oxide is because it shifts almost all colors. But it does it in a way that creates a kind of a glow instead of totally muting it down. So it allows in other words, I could use it on any word and I would get unpredictable results, but at least it would work. And so that's a reference color, you might say, that's going to be fixed in every painting. But of course, every background would be different because it's mixed in the same.
It's interesting how this image that we're seeing here, we can see more of the surface quality.
Yes, we can see more of the texture, and
which I don't want.
And actually have been experimenting with different ways. I've even toyed with Al Held's method of sanding the surface, which is what he did to totally remove texture. I've worked with rollers, but on this one, since I hadn't settled on anything yet, I decided to just brush it on. And yet you can see brush strokes, and because there are many layers of paint that.
If it's more fluid, and that you're working horizontally, then it's going to level out.
It doesn't actually. I work horizontally, and it's very fluid.
Do you use acrylic?
Yes.
Do you use his open acrylic?
They're very fast. I lay on a heavy layer really quickly. But the interesting thing is that
it's just that the open is that it's not drying as quick.
Right, right. The problem is the multiple layers. So as soon as you put the first layer tends to be very smooth, but it's not entirely opaque when you're painting over the other lines. So you can even see the difference in sheen a little bit around the white from painting there, which you can't see in the actual painting. This is sort of picking up all of that texture strangely, looking very different than the paint. Unfortunately for the people viewing, But anyway, so now with the process...
I can see it when I'm looking from the side more. You know, I can see the surface changing.
And I had toyed with the idea of making a really strong texture, too. I just want to get my hand out of it because I want the process to be the controlling factor. Basically, in the way that John Cage sort of turned his choices over to a process outside of himself through chance operations, through throwing the I Ching, I'm turning mine over to the choices of people that died long ago and gave us our language, gave us our words. And of course, they never intended those choices to be mapped into a form, but they were making a functional structure in language. So. In a way,
well,
not,
as words have developed, there's been a hell of a lot of people in helping to do that. So consequently, they're all speaking at the same time.
It's true. That's true. I never thought of that. That's a good way to put it. You're right. There are a lot of people had a hand in that.
And not just one.
No. Oh no. And they would continue to evolve, except that now we've standardized spelling so much because of media, because of, you know, we all, education and media, we don't allow words to change. We don't suddenly start...
Well, we do change them by giving them more meanings, mm-hmm. and consequently they don't mean anything then, the word. Mm-hmm. It becomes meaningless in a way because it has too many. And that's dangerous in a way. In some ways.
It's an interesting issue, the whole issue of language. It's interesting for me that, I mean, from my perspective, people always think, well, there must be a lot of interest because I work with language, and language-based art is so popular. So you see it everywhere. All the museums have paintings with words or words actually placed on the wall. And actually, it's a problem because if curators find out that I work with language and they come and see it, they don't see the language right there in the painting, and they don't, well, you have to think about that. That's just not something we can read.
No, they don't. I mean, it's sort of like Bob Ashley, who works with text. He works with text. He tells stories. Mm-hmm. And from the 60s, he was thinking of it as TV operas. Mm-hmm. And we didn't think of TV as operas. We thought of them as a series. Some of them we wish they'd go away.
That's true. Something interesting has happened recently that's kind of working in my favor. When a lot of the people that the cultural theorists and the philosophers, that deconstructivists, all those that spawned language art as we know it in the museums, the, you know, putting text on walls and things. When those things were developed, the idea of word recognition was a theory called BOMA theory. And basically they thought that we read a word, a written word, by looking at its outline. So we read it very similar to the way that we read an image. You know, we just got
it's a
this
pattern.
Yeah. We
it's
just saw this shape and that identified that as the word. So basically because of that there was thought to be no real difference between reading a word and reading an image. And they started treating them as equal signs. The reality is they just actually discovered that we actually don't read the form and the shape. We read each and every letter of the word, something called parallel letter recognition. So what this means is we are reading the individual letters, and since letters don't have any real form, we tend to think of them as the forms that, you know, that I've shown in the color wheel or whatever, but say Times Roman or, you know, but we can use uppercase, lowercase, Braille, Morse code. A letter can be anything. It's real. It has no physical form. So the materiality of language is an illusion based on typography and text. And it's really the placement of the letter in the alphabet and how it's used in the lexicon of the language that makes a difference. So my work is actually more in line with what's really happening when we're reading than the idea that you can treat a word as an image, because a word really isn't an image, because language, you know, we only have these 26 images and we have the 750,000 words in the English language coming out of just 26 images. So it's not like the meaning we're getting from the whole world of universe of images, you know, that we have. So it's very, it's interesting that it's moving that way.
Is there any culture that is using less?
Less letters? Yeah. Less, fewer letters?
I'm just curious.
I don't really know. I've worked with about 20 languages. I've worked with French, German, Spanish. I've done pieces with those languages, but I've experimented with more. But I've only used the Roman alphabet. So if the language can't be Romanized, I've used Romanized Japanese, but I can't work with Japanese characters. And character languages present an interesting problem because, you know, if alphabetic languages are not really images in the way we read them, but what about calligraphy? You know, what about Chinese characters or Japanese characters? So I don't know enough about them to find out if people are reading strokes or how those things have converted. We you know, there's a very gray area between images and language. And the other interesting thing is that, you know, from these 26 letters, we can create all these images in our heads. You know, you read a book, all this imagery is going on through this code which has no form. So, yet, somehow there has to be a connection, because you couldn't create the mental imagery if there wasn't some sort of a connection, you know, in the human brain somewhere. So it's all very complicated, I tried for a while to speak about some of those things in more detail, and I found that I got deeper and deeper into it's confusion more than anything else.
It's
because
like sinking into the water.
It is. And even people in linguistics, I've shown the forms to people in linguistics, and they say, well, it must be coincidence because the signs of language are arbitrary. We could use anything for the word. And that's one of the founders of linguistics, Saussure. Basically, that's his whole philosophy that linguistics is based on. Yet, it's an assumption. There's no proof the signs of language are arbitrary. And I obviously don't believe they are, which is why, otherwise, where are all these structures coming from? They're coming, you know, they're not intentional, but that doesn't make them arbitrary. They're just, I mean, it's a similar thing to trying to say a Jackson Pollock, you know, paint is arbitrary. It's not. He's, you know, when you look at it, you see structure, you see patterning happening, but it's innate. It's driven
part
by...
Part of it's because of him.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a consistency within that, or a pattern of his particular type of...
Gestures of...
Yes.
of whatever, he called it a trance, but whatever he was doing was creating it.
Or a good bottle of booze.
Yeah, possibly, yes. So there are a lot of complicated issues. For me, I mean, the bottom line is that I like the mystery of where they come from, and I just continue to be fascinated by the form. So I'm always... just trying to see them in a different way. In a way, I'm like a viewer. I'm like everyone who comes to see my work, because my favorite part, and my daughter's the same way, when I take the tape off and you actually get to see the form, my daughter always wants to be there to take the tape off, because that's when it emerges. And you don't know what it will be. It's a surprise to me as anyone who walks in and first sees the painting, because I really didn't draw it. Some other, as you said, many other people did, so...
Have you ever heard of the I guess you would call him a theorist. He was a practitioner of weaving, because he was a chemist, but he, Chevreul?
No, I haven't.
He's a French, he was called in to, because they were having in the government tapestry, they were having trouble with black, and they thought that there was something mechanically wrong, you know, I mean, the way it was made or something like this. And his whole theory was simultaneous contrasts of color, which Elbers doesn't speak much of it, but he almost totally came from it. And it was a book that he wrote on it in the 1830s. And it became in English in 1854. And all the painters used it, clear up to the post-impressionists. And he died at 103. But the thing was, he was a chemist. So what he was doing is trying to figure out this, not from a painter's end, which was very important. And the reason was, it had to do with juxtaposition.
Mm-hmm.
What we see around things. Because we never see a tree by itself, we see it in an environment.
Exactly.
And it affects it. Mm-hmm. This, you know, the background, the ground, everything.
Absolutely.
Is controlling it.
Absolutely. Sometimes I'm really shocked when I mix the yellow oxide for the background and then I take the tape off to see the main line, and it just pops out at you because of the interaction between the, you know, the colors. And that's one reason I chose that. And I used to use the contrasting color to get that effect, to try and make it happen, but now I get to be surprised. And you
well,
know,
I think those are more fun, you know, because hopefully those surprises come from the viewer, the other viewers.
Right. Right,
and,
exactly.
How they respond to it and what they learn from it.
Exactly.
But in the case of Chevreul, he was dealing with tapestry, mm-hmm. so dealing with yarn. And then I think he's incredible. But I don't know that he did anything after that through the rest of his life. But
sounds like quite a bit. I mean, that's when people ask me what I've done for 35 years, and I tell them that I'm a dot connector. Basically, that's what made a career of connect the dots. And I use the same circle and the same 26 dots over and over again. So it doesn't seem like a very rich, 35 years. But for me, it has been because of all the possibilities that come out of it. And it speaks to the process, but it has because it's connected to language. This rich, strange thing.
But that's the whole core of the human being, mm-hmm. is language. Mm-hmm. Whether it be the verbal, the mm-hmm. sound of it, or the visual mm-hmm. element of it, or mm-hmm. what have you.
Or the choices made to create it, which I think that's the thing I keep coming back to now as I get older, is the choices, that... I think for me, thinking about something happened when I was thinking about John Cage doing that, and always wondering whether he was using the I Ching, to me said that he didn't believe in chance. He didn't believe in true chance. In true arbitrariness. He believed in chance, but he didn't believe it was arbitrary. He believed there were powers at work, and so he would get to see this.
Well, the one thing the people have to realize. That when you deal with chance, you're setting up a parameter. So it's not anything can happen. Mm-hmm. It's within a confinement that you have set up. Mm-hmm. And
and your process of how you're using it, in his case.
Yes,
the
it's always got these sidebars, mm-hmm. top and bottom, that are containing it.
Right. Right.
And I found him to be. We made two print editions, it was really great to just have him around because he had this beautiful smile, and it was dominating. I mean, you were affected by it. You would totally become succumbed by this gentleman. This small. I mean, he was structurally not a very tall person. It's just incredible, this big smile.
Well, I think the great thing for me is he sort of gave permission for people like me to take the choices in art out of your own hands, to not be responsible for them. And if it hadn't been for him and Sol LeWitt making processes acceptable, I'm not sure, people would be arguing about whether what I do is even art. But I can just point to John Cage and Sol LeWitt and say, well, it's process, and I'm using choices made by other people. And as far as I know, no one else uses language choices in the way I do. But, just taking it outside of yourself. So, I would like it if I could make no choices, if I could have everything done.
But you can't.
But I can't.
No,
right,
can't.
Exactly.
We've used up our time. And I would like to thank you, Micheal
thank you
Winkler,
so much.
For coming and visiting us. I would like the audience to thank you for tuning in. I'm James Carroll, and good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wells Fargo Foundation.